Hinchliffe. I'm director of the IUCN UK Peatland Programme. As the name suggests, we are a UK-wide programme broadly advocating for the conservation and restoration of peatlands. So we are a partnership organisation. We're comprised of NGOs, government, practitioners, and scientists, academics, which all aim to collectively sort of work towards our cause for conserving UK peatlands. And it's really great to be here at one of the last few peatland life projects in the UK and to celebrate the breadth that life funding really allows projects such as Moor space to explore. And Paul's asked me to set the scene really this morning as to how sort of lowland peatlands in the UK are sort of existing, surviving, hanging on, and really want to just take the opportunity as well to highlight the role that the peatland programme play in supporting all of you in your work and showcase some of the things that we're up to. For the slide, or do I swipe? There we go, good stuff, good stuff. So the cultural and economic perception of peatlands has long been a negative one. Worthless, unpleasant places. Only valuable if drained and turned into something else, or if the peat is dug up and used for fuel or fibre for horticulture. But over the last 50 years, the perception of peatlands has really started to shift. And as governments have become aware initially of the nature conservation importance of peatlands, but also latterly their significance, in tackling climate change as well. And now you'll be aware that peatlands are one of our most abundant semi-natural habitats, covering around 10% of the UK, but previously covered as much as 30% before major agricultural developments of the last few centuries drained them for production. And I don't think it'll have escaped your attention, I'm sure many of you in the room are working on lowland raised bogs and certainly lowland peatlands, that they've been decimated, and that there's just a few fragments of fen and lowland raised bog left in near natural condition, with Natural England reporting that as little as 1% of England's lowland peatlands are reported as in good condition. So this map that I've got up on the screen from Natural England's 2017 257 report highlights the limited areas of undegraded peatlands, and even these small green areas within the region we're in today are likely to be suffering from atmospheric nitrogen deposition and existing in a sort of subpar state. Sorry, it's taking me a bit of a while to get to grips. Am I just tapping on the slide, Paul? Is that essentially how we're working it? Yeah, cool, no worries. So there's a range of land use pressures which have impacted and continue to impact on our lowland peatlands. Development still poses a really real threat, which is just ridiculous when you consider how we now value peatlands and ecosystem services they provide. But there's active proposals in Cheshire and Greater Manchester at the moment, on deep peat areas of lowland raised bog that are currently going through the planning system. Forestry still continues to be a very real pressure in both upland and lowland peatlands, and intensive grazing is a common theme across many of our drained lowland areas. So agricultural use, I would say, is probably the major pressure and land use type. We've got large amounts of lowland raised bog and fen, which are cultivated, and these represent some of our most productive agricultural soils, so there's a real challenge there. You can hopefully make out from the map that's on screen just about that within the lowland areas of Yorkshire and Humberhead, we have some significant areas of fen and lowland raised bog, but also significant areas of wasted peat. That's the darker green category. And this is where the thin remnant peat soils that would once have been deep peat have started to be ploughed into the underlying mineral soil layers. We've got the England Peatland Action Plan published now, and that states that by 2030, so that's what, 7 years, 6.5 years away, we want all of England's soils to be managed sustainably. But we're still awaiting the Lowland Agricultural Peat Task Force report, which will hopefully promote and highlight some of the areas to address and some of the challenges facing lowland peatlands within the agricultural setting that I've just talked about. And there's certain types of current land use and activity on degraded sites that are directly preventing peatland restoration. Now, we're not saying that not all peatland needs to return to full-blown designated nature conservation areas, and there has to be a bit of a pragmatic approach. But there are areas which are high priority for restoration, such as some of the areas of forestry on peatland, where land use and future land management priorities really need to change if we're to collectively achieve net zero and biodiversity conservation agendas. So a strategic approach is needed to all areas of land use policy, and not just existing in the sort of traditional land use silos that we are currently working within. Accessible information on peatlands is usually restricted to deep peat, which in England is typically categorised as more than 40 centimetres depth. And this accounts for around 480,000 hectares when mapped as shown here in brown. But shallow peat, between 10 and 40 centimetres as mapped here, exceeds this land area and is mapped as covering around 520,000 hectares. So I just really wanted to take a moment just to highlight these shallow peatlands, which are somewhat missing from our policy and funding agendas at the moment, and they're particularly extensive in the north and west of the region that we're in today. And that's something that we're exploring as a programme at the moment, and you'll see in the next couple of weeks we'll be publishing a peatland definitions briefing, and specifically looking at challenging some of the sort of existing definitions of peat that exist within policy and practice. So definitions of peat around the world have historically been based on exploitation potential for commercial peat extraction or agricultural purposes, rather than being derived on the basis of hydrology, ecology, biodiversity, and other non-exploitative ecosystem services. And this has given rise to mapping exercises such as this, and policy decisions underpinned by an exploitation-focused system of definitions, which are increasingly at odds with modern recognition and commitment to holistic ecosystem function and ecosystem services provided by our peatlands. Classifications based on these historical data sets using minimum peat depth thresholds results in shallower areas of peatland, which I've already highlighted are really, really extensive, as being completely excluded from policy and land management decisions. But such areas, nonetheless, continue to be substantial carbon stores and are often vital to the wider ecology and functioning of connected deeper peat deposits. They often have their own distinctive biodiversity because they may contribute to important areas of transitional habitat on the edge of our remaining reserves of peat. Achieving climate change and biodiversity objectives requires a much more inclusive approach to peatland classification and mapping, and better recognises ecological function and status, and reflects the full potential of peatland values of all peat, both our deep and shallow areas. So I would argue that there's a really urgent need to examine these lost peatlands that are currently excluded from policy that rely on peat depth, and to assess the implications for strategic objectives. And I know that from, you know, my attendance of previous live projects on Lowland Peat, part of the lessons learned from those projects have been that ensuring adequate provision of inclusion of buffer areas around the lowland raised bogs under conservation, and that's been really identified as critical to achieving the conservation objectives of that habitat. So it's really important that some of these peripheral shallow areas of peat are brought into the discussion today, and that peat is talked about more holistically as a landscape scale restoration and ecosystem process. When we look at the scale of peatland within England, the level of damage and the cost involved can seem like a really daunting task to consider, making a significant land use change and land condition change on. But the economic benefits alone can exceed the cost. So the Office for National Statistics a couple of years ago produced a report that estimated the cost of restoring absolutely all of the UK peatlands to near natural condition would be somewhere between 8.4 and 22 billion. But restoring all of this peat would deliver carbon benefits alone of £109 billion, and that would outweigh the cost of doing so by an estimated 5 to 10 times. And the ONS report goes on to classify peatland restoration as very high value for money, and that's only examining carbon benefit. But aside from the direct economic benefits, there's a multitude of other ecosystem service benefits which are delivered by healthy peatlands. One which is locally pertinent would be restored peatlands are capable of intercepting and storing greater volumes of water than damaged ones, releasing the water over longer periods of time and mitigating flood risk. Management techniques, including draining, burning, and overgrazing, have been implicated in both declining water quality and some of the larger flood events in England in recent years, such as this example of the floods in Fish Lake just north of Doncaster in 2019. There's a very real funding gap at the moment that we are in, and I'm sure a lot of the practitioners in the room will be well aware of the sort of restricted nature of funding pots that we have available at the moment. So the funding gap really is around about £560 million, and that's the funding that's required to meet the current target commitments that the sort of England and the UK governments have made. That's not even, you know, fixing everything, but again, coming back to that pragmatic approach, it's probably not possible to look at that in the whole picture. So we need to look at ways in which we can address this funding gap. And the complexity of funding mechanisms and the delivery of funding is a real significant barrier to progress in some areas. So in England, you'll all be aware, there's been a series of short-term funding schemes made available through governments, such as the current Nature for Climate grant scheme. But there's a lot of uncertainty still with what post-cap agri-environment schemes will provide and what ELMS is going to look like. And that has led to real reticence in the landowning community in actually actively undertaking restoration projects at the moment, and quite a lot of them are sort of saying they're going to wait until they know what the financial position really looks like. And one of the ways of addressing that funding gap is through the application of blended or private finance. So the IUCN UK Peatland Programme developed and continued to manage the Peatland Code, which some of you hopefully have heard of. The codes are government, UK government-backed domestic voluntary carbon market standard that landowners with eligible peatland can follow to attract private finance for peatland restoration by effectively selling the carbon units generated by that restoration. And the code is currently the only standard for peat, including agricultural peat soils. There's other codes that are starting to focus on mineral soils, but the Peatland Code is the only one for peat. And we continue to work closely with government to ensure that developing public finance schemes will integrate with the code and other private finance options. Again, some of you who've been following the sort of the news of the code and are maybe actively integrating it into your projects will have heard the news that a couple of months ago we updated the code to version 2, which was some quite significant updates. So we changed some of our emissions factors. They were updated to allow us to continue to align the code with the UK greenhouse gas inventory. And for the first time, we have moved away sort of a focus on bogs within the original peatland code, and we've been able to include fen peatland categories within the code for the first time. So that's a really big step forwards that's hopefully going to open up quite a lot of potential for large amounts of private investment in some of the UK's most heavily degraded and heavily emitting lowland peatlands. Now, I have to be honest, for the inclusion of fens in the peatland code, it has not been plain sailing, and there's had to be some amendments and prescriptions made for these projects due to the lack of direct greenhouse gas measurements that are available within the UK for some of the fen categories. So the lack of greenhouse gas data for some of these agricultural settings currently limits the inclusion of some lowland peatland types and potential future polluticulture types. So we're about to launch a call for evidence, and we're certainly aligning with the government's polluticulture, polluticulture exploration fund, a bit of a mouthful, to help accelerate this as well. So there are some areas of lowland fen that are under particularly productive use at the moment that we just don't have the emissions data for, so we're looking to try and address that. And of course, if we want to really future-proof restoration, we're going to have to think strategically. So in times when budgets are ever more squeezed and other priorities are coming to the fore, once again, we as a community are going to have to make the case as to why peatlands are a positive investment. So the IUCN UK Peatland Programme will continue to bring evidence to the fore to support those who are making the case for peatlands. And again, for those of you who've been following, it's 5 years since the strategy launched, and we're planning to produce the first interim report on its implementation this year with a view to summarising national and UK-wide progress against the targets that are set within the UK peatland strategy and national targets also, and a number of key indicators of delivery. So this is a particularly challenging task for us because there is still no coordinated national level summary available in England for indicators of progress, including very simple metrics that are gathered, such as annual hectares of peatland restored. It's just really, really difficult to get that data. So we're having discussions actively with government at the moment about how to progress that. We need to make really clear research and monitoring asks to meet our needs. So what are we doing? Is restoration working, and how do we know it's working? What are we monitoring? So greenhouse gas, emissions, biodiversity, habitat conservation goals, land use, water. We need to evidence the resilience and sustainability of restoration. And that's really vital to be able to continue to make the case for investment and demonstrate effective delivery. Long-term monitoring is also really, really key, and you've probably heard people from the programme talk about this before, but it's really vital to be able to identify the best and most cost-effective techniques whilst ensuring we can avoid perverse policy recommendations which can result from short-term data collection and what effectively is a long-term trajectory. We know obviously peatlands have developed over such a long time scale. Measuring effects from a restoration project over the 3 years that the project is funded for can give a very different result to measuring the trajectories over the long term. So we need to be very careful about the conclusions and the way they're presented from some of the data we are collecting. We as a community really still struggle to answer and evidence some key questions on peatlands. And whilst peatland research and monitoring needs to be more effectively resourced, we also need to make sure that we are coordinating and collaborating as much as possible to avoid duplication and maximise the addressing of data gaps. And I would just like to make a plea as well that I think biodiversity is probably the area of monitoring that always falls short on a lot of projects. So I know that monitoring costs for most project funding are really, really limited. And so they tend to focus on sort of being able to demonstrate the delivery of the project, you know, the amount of sphagnum that you've planted and the amount that's grown, these really visible indicators that are really key and really important. But it does leave us in a position where continually we haven't got a clue, you know, how many dunlin are supported by our upland peatlands or how some of our reptile communities are fared by areas of restored peatlands and whether restoration is actually working to deliver for them. So there's a lot of key questions around biodiversity that are remaining. Eyes on the Bog is an initiative that the programme helped to set up to play a role in sort of plugging the longer term data gap that I've talked about. So one thing that can be quite useful in some of these projects is building a volunteer community to support citizen science initiatives alongside peatland restoration projects. And that's been shown to be a real success in some areas in terms of both engaging local communities about the importance of peatland restoration that's happening locally to them, but also in supporting the peatland conservation agenda with a tangible output, you know, scientific data that can help further research, policy and funding for the peatland restoration agenda more widely. So Eyes on the Bog was rolled out and has been set up on 50 plus sites to date. And it's really a standardised methodology that enables individual peatland sites to be consistently monitored across the UK, creating this network of comparable sites which are generating long-term data. So the Eyes on the Bog initiative employs cheap and very simple techniques and modern technology combined to enable useful monitoring information to be collected by peatland community employees or even volunteer base. Landowners and land managers obviously play an absolutely vital role in all this, and we really must include them and bring them along with us as part of the picture. So there's a huge proportion of the UK's peatlands are privately owned. So they're probably the most important current and potential future enablers of peatland restoration. Without their consent, a lot of the progress to date wouldn't have happened. And we need landowners to be encouraged and supported in the long term to manage and restore peatlands sustainably. Early adopters of peatland restoration at scale on different land use types, for example, you know, upland estates, grouse moor estates, for example, or lowland productive agricultural land, have really helped to pave the way forwards for peatland restoration becoming mainstream land management. And demonstration sites and kind of walk and talk events, the sort of thing that you'll do tomorrow as a community, but thinking about engaging that broader range of stakeholders, can be really, really powerful. And there's certainly an element of peer pressure and seeing what others have done before taking the plunge yourself, which has encouraged further landowners to engage in restoration schemes. Taking an example from Scotland, the local provision of land management advice has been really key as an enabler in Scotland to encourage local groups to engage in the government-funded restoration schemes delivered through Peatland Action. And they deploy a dedicated team of advisors across Scotland to help support land managers and owners in sort of developing their peatland restoration schemes right from the early sort of concept right through to delivery and sort of 10-year monitoring plans that are attached to all restoration schemes in Scotland. So that's just to highlight a sort of a model that has been really, really successful for national rollout and adoption of restoration in Scotland. But there's a lot more that needs to be done to signal long-term government policy and funding support to encourage rapid landowner sign-up to peatland restoration schemes. And rewards for healthy peatlands as well. So, you know, we need to start and think about beyond restoration. How do we want to preserve our restored and support our recovering peatlands in the long term? We're very, very focused on sort of the next 10 years, but we do need to be thinking about what the future looks like. And what incentive is there for landowners and managers to maintain peatlands which are already in good condition in a positive way? What incentives need to be in place to ensure adequate support for recovery? Capacity and skills is something, Capacity and skills is something that we always come back to. So even with the money that's available at present, government schemes are having a real difficult time in spending the existing budgets that they've got. And contractor capacity is one of the major issues. So operating heavy plant on waterlogged soils is very, very skilled work. And there's a limited number of contractors which can undertake restoration work to a high standard. So there's a few training programmes and engagement events that are underway to try and remove that bottleneck, but it is still a real challenge and it will take time to resolve. Local solutions for local problems also helps to deal with some of these issues of sort of delivering sustainable restoration locally as well. So So I know in the North Pennines, for example, they're looking at undertaking local polluticulture trials for growing sphagnum as sort of farmed donor sites for supporting their restoration work, because to be honest, they're struggling to get the volume of sphagnum into some of their projects. So they're looking at kind of local supply and local solutions for that. And I just thought this was a nice example in Shetland as well of recycling discarded salmon smolt nets from the salmon fishing industry. And instead of using sort of coir or geojute matting or other mechanisms, they're recycling and using those nets to help stabilise large areas of bare peat. So it's just a nice example of local contractors thinking a bit outside the box and bringing these different people, these different sort of people from different sectors into the peatland community. The sort of innovation that can happen is really, really quite amazing and quite encouraging. I couldn't come to a Lowland Peat conference and not touch on polluticulture. It's obviously the buzzword at the moment and everyone's starting to think about it, which is great, because I think it does represent real opportunities for many of our Lowland peatlands. But I really just want to highlight that polluticulture is not a panacea for all Lowland raised bogs and fens at all, but it will offer some opportunities. I think especially in areas where productive and economically viable agricultural production is threatened by soil loss. So the way that we're thinking about polluticulture as a programme is that it's a very broad term which encompasses all types of wetland farming, right from grazing you sort of your native cattle on your wet blanket bog hilltops down to the really intensive sort of reed production or even sphagnum production on lowland peat. But the key thing to remember is that peat must be re-wetted and kept wet. There's a number of principles that we're considering as a programme trying to highlight, and again look out for a polluticulture principles briefing coming in the next few weeks from us. But there's a few things just to highlight, such as ensuring that remnant semi-natural peatland is preserved and not converted over to sort of more productive use through the advocacy of polluticulture, making sure we're integrating and maximising biodiversity benefits on all of these sites. So even when you're considering monoculture, really intensive production of a crop, for example, you know, growing celery on a re-wetted field, there are still biodiversity benefits that can be gained from that, and just sort of tweaking the harvesting regime or tweaking the management of the buffer areas around that field, there are ways that we can manage nature delivery as well as sort of the mitigating the climate benefits as well. And I think the focus as well is that really polluticulture should be seeking to go towards carbon sequestration and delivering kind of carbon max where possible. Emissions reduction isn't enough, and obviously our peatlands in a natural, healthy, functioning state would be acting as a net carbon sink anyway. So let's do what we can to move them back towards that scenario. But obviously we don't understand a huge amount about how polluticulture and lowland peat management will impact on greenhouse gas emissions, especially on our shallow peats. So there's definitely a research gap there for somebody. And I'd just like to finish up when it'll load my last slide. By again, just bringing us back to thinking beyond restoration and establishing this long-term vision for lowland peat. So the peatlands of the future should really represent a better balance of land use which reflect their true value to society and seek to integrate carbon, water, and the full range of benefits we get from these habitats as healthy, functioning landscapes. So road mapping right now is needed to identify what we as a community can achieve. But it's also really important not to get hung up on everything being insurmountable and difficult. It's all about the small steps right now, and the focus has to be making progress and quickly with those small steps. So thank you for listening. We're always here as a peatland programme with our sort of variety of resources to support you in your work, and we're always here as quite a big team now. We've got 8 people in post. So we're here to sort of to help support you and network with the people you think might be able to help, or if there's anything we can do to help sort of support you in developing our resources and support your projects and your work, then do let us know. So thank you.
Thank you for inviting me. It's not an all Durham morning, because I happen to know Emma was born there and grew up just not far from where I now live. So I don't think, Jenny, you've got any relationship. Okay, so it's not an all Durham morning. My name's Fred Worrall. I know a number of you, I've worked with a number of you, so thank you for inviting me here this morning. I've said mixed tales from the moors. I think that's my sort of warning that I don't have all good news for you this morning. And I'm really going to talk about Thorn and Hatfield, so my apologies. I made the assumption that a lot of you would be familiar with Thorn and Hatfield, and therefore just you might store some of my information for those of you who are visiting for the first time tomorrow. As to what the pictures are. That's actually Thorn in the background in bloom. I'm going to talk about some of the monitoring, some of the measurement, and some of the modelling that we've done on those particular bogs, and this is work partly sponsored by Ormond Survey and partly sponsored by Natural England. And so just to acknowledge my colleagues, Donna, Harry, Jason and Jamie from Ordnance Survey and a number from Natural England, but I've grouped them all under Julian's name, so they're all Julian for this morning. Does that work? Tap the screen. Yay. Why Thorn and Hatfield? Lowland bogs particularly have a large capacity. The picture there is actually of Tim. I think some of you will know Tim. Stood at the Polish monument on Southern Hatfield. And you'll see that therefore there's a large amount of peat missing. And the great advantage of lowland peats, because they've been dug over, etc., is that they have the hydrological capacity and setting to have a lot greater depth of peat. Estimates for Hatfield are about 5 metres of peat missing. And you can see there between the 1941 surface and the current surface, there's at least the standard issue measurement of a TIM missing of peat. Now, we can assume that Tim is about 2 metres, and therefore there's at least 2 metres missing of peat there. The other great advantage we have on Thorn and Hatfield is that they are actually, because they're NNRs and they're in ownership, they represent a large area in isolated within that landscape, so that they're actually relatively easy to study. They're in a relatively flat landscape. They stand out. That's just a Google Earth image. And therefore, it actually created and it's in one ownership. It created an area for which we could develop tools for actually handling management, assessing capacity, and also then developing towards various of the carbon trading offsetting schemes like Peatland Code that Emma mentioned, but also Vera, which some of you might well know as well. And finally, it means that under the NNR, with the thanks to Natural England locally, that we were able to experiment with how we might enhance the capacity or use some of that capacity whilst safely maintaining it as an NNR. So we've been able to experiment there. And I'll talk this morning about biochar, which I think Jenny will also mention in a different context in a moment. So to start with, I want to talk about some of the experimentation, so the measurement and interventions there, and this is based around the idea of biochar. If we've got a large capacity at Thorn and Hatfield, and we've got a capacity that might equal, for example, making the whole of Doncaster County Council, City Council population net zero within a few years, it's a massive capacity, then we need to know how to fill that capacity and realise that capacity. We effectively need to enhance that peatland sequestration. So the idea is that we could add biochar. Biochar is a refractory material, it can be made sustainably, and therefore we need to know whether it has an impact and whether it delivers that. So we've done a trial, we're 15 months into the trial, 13 months into the trial, sorry. There we're looking at three cells, so these are the original dug over cells in a row, a couple of hundred meters worth, and we actually have three locations with respect to water table, that's wet to dry. Remember, this is Hatfield, dry is relative. It's basically wet, wet, and wet. There's the three locations, or it certainly is in winter. We have three treatments, which are a control, a half dose, and a full dose. To give you an idea, we're talking about around about the top dose is 64 tons dry weight, wet weight of biochar. That's not carbon, 64 tons per hectare equivalent, not 64 tons on one experiment. To give you practically what that means, that's about a 2 centimetre layer of biochar being applied to the surface, a 1 centimetre layer of biochar being applied to the surface, and a control. We monitor it then for a number of things, water quality, water table, which is really just the covariate in the system, soil temperature, I'll explain why we want soil temperature in a moment, gas flux, net ecosystem exchange of that, and some then properties of the plant and surface properties. We want to know that the plants are thriving. We want to know how the surface properties have changed. So to give you some results, not all of our results, does that show up so well? One of the things we're actually interested in is how that monitoring that surface and whether the actual plants are surviving. In effect, we just were very worried that we were going to kill anything. That's what we were worried about. Plants, animals, PhD students. Anything out there that we were. So one way of doing that is actually monitoring the albedo. The albedo is the surface reflectance. Biochar is a very matte black material. Now, you might go peat bogs are sort of matte black material, but that's but vegetation isn't. It's green, or at least light brown. And so therefore we can monitor albedo. And actually what we find is that it really behaves well as a way of monitoring the surface. You might see on the top graph there, what we see is that these are all relative to the pre-treatment control. We see that actually as we add biochar through the half dose, the full dose, etc., what we're seeing is that we are actually seeing the albedo drop, i.e. the surface reflectance is going down. The surface gets darker as you add biochar. Now that's actually quite easy to spot. It's a significant effect and we can trace it over time. So that's what we've done on the second graph there. As you can see, what happens, we applied, the biochar was applied in March, and therefore there's a big difference. Those treated plots, their albedo drops, the control plots, basically nothing happens. As the cotton grass comes in, the albedo goes back up. There's still a significant difference, but that difference between the treated and the untreated plots diminishes over time, such that this time, in fact last month, there was no significant difference. You couldn't tell from the albedo that there was biochar actually there. Hatfield Moors is cotton grass dominated, as you'll see tomorrow if you don't know it. Therefore, what has happened is the cotton grass has actually grown through. And therefore, we're actually now, the surface looks the same. We're waiting to see whether it will bloom in the same way and flower in the same way. And so therefore, we're waiting for sort of next month, maybe early June, to see that. So there's no hint that we've damaged the surface here. In effect, the cotton grass has just carried on. Biochar is an alkaline material. It's about pH 8. Peat bogs are not pH 8, and therefore we don't want the biochar to actually affect that surface in terms of in terms of its pH balance. And so therefore there was a legitimate concern that we'd dump 2 centimetres biochar onto the surface and it would start damaging that peat because it was no longer acid. The answer is it changes it slightly, but not by very much. It is significant, but we go from about pH 4 to about pH 4.2. Yeah, we're not changing to an alkali system. There is a significant difference. Again, all the graphs I show you today are all relative to the pre-treatment control. So all the axes are around about 1, because 1 is the pre-treatment control. And over time, we have actually seen that difference be maintained. The biggest difference was actually changing water table. So the biggest difference control on pH was not adding biochar, but whether the water table was high or not, or low, as it was throughout last summer. But again, no evidence yet of anything that would particularly damage the nutrient balance. We do have information on nutrient balances. We do have information on metals in there as well. Just wanted to also show you some pictures that we can't animate on this particular screen. So just to show you some pictures, left-hand one, as you look at it, that's the view across the site in sort of, I guess that's actually about sort of springtime. That's looking from one of the cells into the middle cell to the east, to the row car entrance. And that's what they look like a lot of the time, relatively wet, but areas of high ground. And so we've exploited that within the controls. The middle image is cotton grass growing through biochar. That's a 1 centimetre layer of biochar on there. That's one of our experimental plots. You see the cotton grass looks relatively happy. You can see biochar in there, but you'll see that cotton grass isn't dying off. And the image on the right-hand side is actually sphagnum growing on top of of the biochar. That's actually on one of the wet treatments, and you can actually see, if you look very carefully, there's green stuff growing on it, and it is sphagnum. Cotton grass coming through, but still there, actually sphagnum in there. We do measure DOC as one of part of the carbon flux, so dissolved organic carbon. I'm showing you the absorbance data here because it's more complete. Do we see an absorbance effect? Yes, we do. There is a slightly raised DOC under the biochar. That's actually the reverse of what I expected. I expected the biochar to absorb the DOC. That's part of our carbon budgeting on this site. It is slightly that the great thing about Hatfield in that sense is that's not a concern, because very little water actually leaves Hatfield. Only in the wettest months of January and February does water actually leave Hatfield. So yes, there's a slightly raised DOC. Does it affect the carbon budget particularly? No, because that's not exported to anywhere else. And that is a persistent effect over the 12 to 13 months so far. Just to show you some CO2 data, we do see raised CO2 fluxes with biochar treatment. It appears to be more or less the same between the two treatments relative to the control. Again, this is relative to the control. And we do see that persistent over the year. Even this time of year, we're seeing higher CO2 fluxes from our treated sites. We don't think that's a very big effect. Remember, this is all relative to the control rather than the absolute values. And I'm not showing you at the moment what the primary productivity effect is. I'm just showing that it does appear that there is a slightly higher respiration under the biochar treatments. That might be the biochar rotting, or we've questioned whether in fact it's the biochar actually adding to the warming of the soil, and that's why we're now measuring soil temperature as well. So we're trying to analyse soil temperature under these plots just to check whether it's the biochar that's actually decomposing, that's degrading, or whether it's actually the biochar warming the peat and that then is degrading. We don't know that, but it's not a big effect. So overall, we're still getting carbon storage. We are just getting this slightly additional effect here. To move on to some of our tool development, this is to show you some of the things that we've been doing as well. And this is data supplied from Natural England and then mapped by the ordnance, our colleagues at the Ordnance Survey. So we have the new peat depth surveys across the site. That's resurveyed in the end of 2022. And it can be compared to the original CEH survey that was pre-coming into ownership in 2004, but the survey is 2002. It's not completely for the site of Hatfield, so there's the current peat depth map for Hatfield, mapped on Natural England's data and OS's mapping. And there's the comparison at the bottom. That is good news. There's actually the peat depth has diminished quite dramatically over the time. The average loss over the time since 2002 is 2 centimetres a year, 2.2 centimetres per year. Now, it's possible that there was still some peat extraction going on in those last few years, and that's what's actually causing that big loss. But actually, it also implies that that's not been then reversed since then. So the peat is now shallower than we expect, and it is still wasting. Now, there is some evidence to back that up from two different sources. Tapping the screen is finding difficult. That is, we're thankful to Julian, who went out and measured 70-something tree stumps, or got somebody to measure 70-something tree stumps. You might see these tomorrow on Hatfield, I don't know. There's a whole series of tree stumps have appeared. Those tree stumps couldn't have been visible while it was being milled. And so therefore the depth between the top of the tree stump and the peat surface highlights how much peat must have disappeared since milling stopped. Now it's possible that there was a height of peat on top of that, and it's possible that the tree stump has slightly moved as well within that timescale. But measuring those, the average loss is about 1.2 centimetres per year. Now this means that with these estimates, we can now actually look, we can give an amount of time for how much longer Hatfield has. Yeah? So we've got an estimate of about 2 from the peat depth survey, we've got an estimate of about 1 from the tree stump survey. That can be mapped, and that's what Ordnance Survey has done in the bottom there. That's the time till there being no more peat left. Yeah? That's actually quite a dramatically red map. Yeah? Red isn't good, red is bad. Yeah? In fact, green isn't that good, it's just better than red. So in some areas, the average time left for Hatfield peat is 30 to 35 years, and in some areas, it's a decade. So that's actually problematic in terms of the future of these moors. To give some backup evidence to this, we also recently got radiocarbon data from Thorn Moors, so the one to the north, which we would expect Thorn and Hatfield to be pretty similar. They have slightly different management histories, I know that, but in terms of their ages. So we took a core from Thorn Moors. For those of you who know Thorn, it was near Blue Bridge, so mainly in the centre. The base of the peat is about 3,000 years BP, so it was sort of what's that early Bronze Age. That's sort of the cause with what we know. And the surface of the peat is about 1,000 years. So remember, this is a dug-over peat, so the surface should be old, yeah? And it's about 1,000 years BP. Now, one of the reasons we actually wanted to do this is part of another project, not part of the project funded by OS and Natural England, was we wanted to actually measure the capacity of the peat. So we could measure where the peat surface would have been, yeah? How old is the peat, how fast was it accumulating, and where would the peat surface have been, so we can measure capacity. Unfortunately, this isn't actually that good news story either, because what it tells us is actually there wasn't as much peat accumulation, or the rate of accumulation wasn't as fast as we would have expected, partly because the bottom of the peat is actually slightly younger than we expected, and the top of the peat is slightly even younger than we expected. This can be explained by either that the peat accumulation was originally slower, that the current surface is still receding and wasting, remember that's what we've seen on Hatfield, or indeed that modern carbon from that revegetated surface is actually contaminating the whole sample. But it's sort of now consistent with a picture that we have that maybe actually the peat on Hatfield is still in trouble, the peat on Thorn is still in trouble. We've been doing modelling, and again, with the resurvey of vegetation, this has all been done by remote sensing and UAV. So that's been resurveyed with the peatland code and Vera constraints in mind, and then remodelled. So we have at the top an image that got reclassified in terms of its vegetation. That's just a selection. We have the revegetate the new map at the bottom. That's of Hatfield in terms of those classes, and then we could actually apply the modelling. The modelling was based on the Durham Carbon model. It's based on 55 management cells known as guests and guest classification in Vera, slightly different from the peatland code. And then we looked at the current and restored scenario. The current scenario is that we now know that 41% of Hatfield is a net source. That's consistent with our carbon stock type measurements from tree stumps and peat depth, but it also means that there is 59% where it is actually a net sink at the moment of carbon and greenhouse gases. Under the restored scenario, that percentage, 41 of those being sources, actually drops to zero. Yeah, none of it becomes sources. So there is a sense here that the modelling implies that the whole of Hatfield could be a net sink, that it currently isn't a net sink, and that's consistent with what was measured from the tree stumps, the radiocarbon, and indeed the peat depth surveys. We have also been developing, as part of the tool development, we've been developing maps of the whole of British peat. That's Great Britain, there's not UK, we didn't have Northern Ireland. And we've been basing this on idea that we could track the history of peatlands from remote sensing. The underlying idea, which actually was developed at Thorn, was that a bare peat is, and a dug over peat is dark, it's warm, and it's dry. And a restored peat is green, wet, and cold. Those properties are things we can track from space. So it means that we can actually look at the health of Hatfield and Thorn back in the beginning pre, whilst it's still being dug over, pre-ownership by then English Nature. And that means all of that can be remote sensed and tracked over time. That can be done for all of the peat bogs in the UK, in Great Britain, it's not the UK. And we could therefore develop some ideas of state, of their condition, and their trajectory. Based on that, we then developed a peat health index, and we can actually say which ones are effectively bad getting better, bad getting worse, good getting better, and good getting worse. So that's what we've done here. That's the map. That's not an OS map, you can tell, because it's not very nice. OS produced very nice maps. That's one of my maps, which is why it doesn't have a proper outline and wrong colour scheme and all those sorts of things. So I'm apologising on behalf of the Ordnance Survey there. The Hatfield, unfortunately, gets the lowest rating. And the reason is actually a bit more complicated. We've been able to include control sites in this analysis. So getting worse is relative, condition is relative to a control site. Trajectory is relative to control site. What appears to be happening on Hatfield is the site is improving, but it's not as improving as fast as we would expect from its control site. So therefore, in relative terms, it's actually getting slightly worse. So again, unfortunately, the remote sensing would actually categorize it in that lowest bracket. So to actually bring together some conclusions from what we've done. Our biochar, we have, biochar, the trial has had minimal impact. We haven't killed anything. It was my real concern. I know I joke about it, but I was really concerned that we'd find dead vegetation, dead animals. Really, I was, because I know full well that I'd get a phone call and told, you're not carrying on with the trial. It does improve carbon storage. There is improved carbon storage, and we've not done anything damaging to the water quality, the nutrient status, or the pH status of the bog. So it looks, in that sense, safe and working. The problem with biochar is that it's too expensive. Yeah, it's uneconomic. You can't get enough of it, and it's very costly. So that limits its actually applicability in these sorts of cases. It appears to work, but it is actually relatively costly, and relatively in short supply over an area if you have to apply over very large areas. In terms of the future of the moors, this is where we've got a sort of consistent sort of picture, which isn't brilliant news. The stocks modelling from either tree stumps or depth measurements imply that the surface is still wasting. The modelling implies that large areas, though not the majority, is also a source. And the remote sensing implies that the moors haven't been able to improve fast enough or as fast as we might hope. And so therefore, relatively speaking, their trajectory isn't excellent. Do we have some alternatives? I know full well that actually with most lowland bogs, what we've got to do is raise the water table. That's difficult at Hatfield. We need to lower the relative water table at Hatfield, it appears. That's why we were using biochar to infill the surface, and therefore lower the water table, create a surface that could be vegetated. Well, as I said, biochar appears relatively impractical for supply and economic reasons, if not for scientifically. And therefore raise the surface by infilling, but we need to do that with something that's relatively cheap and plentiful. The suggestion I would make is that using of cheap local biomass, heather, birch brush, the sorts of things that are available and can be used. Now, the reason we use biochar is it's refractory, whereas heather biomass or birch biomass, etc., wouldn't be so refractory. We've done the theoretical calculations, and it is true. Heather brush would not be as effective as biochar, but it would still be effective. Yeah, and if it's in supply and it's cheaper, then it might well be a different way forward. So to conclude, I'm afraid, as I said, when I said it was mixed tails, I'm afraid that perhaps it's more, the moors in their carbon terms are not particularly thriving. They're still under significant threat of wastage. And I'm not sure there's much more time left to act. We're talking about potentially a decade before we see loss of peat in many areas, particularly across Hatfield. And there's a beautiful shot of Hatfield looking excellent last summer. Thank you.
I'm Jenny from the Centre for Ecology and Hydrology, and I'm a greenhouse gas flux scientist that is predominantly working in agricultural lowland peat at the minute. So I'm going to talk to you about two projects that I've been working on in the last year and a half. So the first one I'm going to talk to you about is the Tesco WWF project that we've been working with NIAB. We've just written a report and hoping to get it published in the next sort of 6 weeks. So look out for that one. And then we've got the GGR peat project, which is part of the larger greenhouse gas remover demonstrator program, which is funded by BBSRC. A bit slow, isn't that? So I just want to introduce the triple challenge sort of concept. So we need to meet the food needs of the world while tackling the climate crisis and reversing the loss of nature. This is a global problem. And in terms of lowland peat, there we go. In terms of lowland peat, that means we've got really productive systems that are deeply unsustainable. So we produce a lot of veg on our lowland peat, but we have really, really high emissions, and we have biodiversity loss across the landscapes. And apologies to the people that were at Fenland Soil, because you've probably seen this graph about 10 times now. But this is this was published in Nature by Evans in 2021. And it's just the relationship between water table depth and carbon loss from our peat. So on the right-hand side, you have deeply drained systems, which is your drier areas. So that's croplands and grasslands. And on the left, you've got your wetter areas, so that's bog and fen. And you can see that with wetter conditions, we lose less carbon, and that's purely because the peat isn't being oxidised. And obviously, the impact that has is peat wastage, so we see a lot of subsidence across our these landscapes. And over time, that could mean that we completely lose all our peat. So I'm just going to give you a policy context. So the UK6 carbon budget has set out that to contribute towards meeting net zero by 2050, we need to restore 25% of our lowland peat. We need to convert 15% of the lowland peat to pluriculture, and then we need to practice wetter farming on 35% of lowland peat. So what are our options to reduce carbon emissions across these landscapes? So there's lots of different options, but I just want to show you the range of water table depths. So conventional veg farming, deeply drained systems, really high CO2 emissions. Wetter farming, we continue to grow crops, but we pick the crops that can deal with wetter conditions. We reduce our CO2 emissions. We're not net zero, but we can see huge emission reductions. We can opt for polluticulture options and really, really manage the water table depths to the point that we are not emitting any carbon. Or we could have wetland management systems and become a net sink, but we need to be considerate of the fact that we will see methane emissions with higher water table depths. So hopefully, yeah, I think it's okay. We put this together, we just wanted to summarise really what all the options are and what impacts, what are the trade-offs? What are the trade-offs between productivity, biodiversity and emissions? So on the top, we have our conventional drainage. That's business as usual for the farming sector. We have regenerative practices. And I think the key message here is that we can't really reduce our greenhouse gas emissions with the typical conventional regenerative practices on our lowland peat systems. So that includes reduced till, energy, improving nutrient use efficiency and things like that. And that's purely because the highest amount of emissions that are coming from our lowland peat systems in agriculture are actually coming from the fact that we are draining these systems. So I just think that's important to note. We also have wetter farming opportunities, and again, if we implement regenerative farming practices, we might see slight reduction in emissions, but obviously the wetter practices provide the biggest emission reductions in comparison to the regenerative farming practices. But that doesn't mean it doesn't have other benefits. So these techniques do have benefits for biodiversity, and there might be a slight trade-off in productivity. So this table was produced by Liz Stockdale. So the report, we tried to identify which crops we could either relocate off of peat because they can't deal with wetter farming sort of conditions, and there's crops that we can sort of implement wetter farming conditions. So celery and lettuce there are people that are actually trialling polluticulture with these crops. So we know that these can deal with the wetter conditions. But a lot of the other crops is sort of a really big unknown, and it's a massive research gap. So we need to look into this, because we can't be advising farmers to practice wetter farming when we can't give them any advice as to what water table depths their crops can deal with without their crops failing. So other options are full re-wetting. So we've touched on polluticulture, and you can see that we decided to change the actual crop type there. There are some food crops, so like we mentioned, celery and lettuce, that you can grow under these conditions. But predominantly, we're looking at different sort of crops, so biomass crops. And we've put a little plus and a minus on the greenhouse gas emissions, because it's a big unknown. We don't really know what type of management, water table management, what sort of level of control we can have, and whether we're going to be a sink or a source. And it might be seasonal variations. It might differ when we're harvesting the crop. There's just lots of unknowns. So that's why we've put that there. But there is the potential to be a sink and capture carbon. So then we have restoration options, and we have carbon farming options too. And then in terms of emissions, we can see that we're actually removing carbon from the atmosphere, but we have really low productivity, but really beneficial for the biodiversity. So what might this look like across the landscape? So we tried to put this infographic together to try and demonstrate that we are advocating for a mosaic landscape. We're not saying that everyone should be farming over here and polluting over there. It's really based on the land managers. It's really based on the farmers' knowledge of the land. They know the areas in which they can drain, they know the areas that are wet and they really struggle to drain that might pose opportunities for restoration projects. So we've got on the landscape, all the little carrots are wetter farming practices. So when I say wetter farming practices, I mean raising the water table to about 45 centimetres. So it's not full re-wetting. We are still emitting carbon. We've got vertical farm options with solar panels on re-wetted land, which could power the vertical farming systems. We've got polluticulture trials, fields near the river. And it's all going to be based on where we can re-wet, where can we do certain activities. But obviously, we need to start thinking about where can we actually achieve the highest emission reductions. So these are the emission factors from the Evans paper. And you can see that deep peat, so this is peat that is greater than 40 centimetres in depth, has the highest emissions. So we're looking at 45 tonnes of CO2 per hectare per year. By the wetter farming, so that's basically halving the water table depth. So this is bringing the water table up to 45 centimetres for the cropland. We can reduce the emissions by half. That's pretty substantial. But then if we look at the wasted peat, there is no difference. So on the shallower peats that with peat depth that doesn't exceed 40 centimetres, it doesn't matter if you implement wet and farming, we have the same emission factors. So if we're looking at reducing carbon, so rather than actually becoming a sink, we should be prioritising our deep peat areas. And likewise, sort of similar trend for grasslands, but they generally have a lower emission factor purely because they are managed a little bit wetter than the croplands. So for the WWF work, we decided to model what sort of emission reductions we could achieve if we restored 25% of the landscape and we practice wetter farming on all of the deep peat in England. So we created these maps. We have the Lowland Peat map, and then we overlaid this with the UKECH land cover crop map, and we were able to develop maps for the whole of England and identified where vegetables are grown, where grass is grown, and where cereal is grown, and whether it's done on deep or wasted peat. I don't know if you can see that very well there. Just to show you some other areas. So there's the northwest there, and you can see there's an area that's predominantly vegetables and cereals, but then further north it's grass. And then we've got the Somerset levels, which is mainly in grass. Just to highlight that there's different places doing different things. Oop. This is very slow. So, when we model the actual emission reductions potential, we looked at lots of different scenarios. So, do we prioritise our cereal to be displaced off of peat and grow it on mineral soils? Do we do it up for vegetables? Which crops? And so we've got different scenarios there, but basically we didn't really see much of a difference between the different scenarios. The main emission reductions came from the fact that we brought the water table up, we restored 25% of the landscape, and it didn't really matter which crops we decided to move to shift off. And the emission savings are equivalent to 5 billion miles travelled in a small petrol car. Oop. So again, pretty substantial. So I'm now, my little square's moved. I'm now going to talk about polluticulture. So that's on the GGRP project. I'm going to bring you back to this graph. So the GGRP project, what we're trying to achieve is actually becoming a carbon removal system. So you can see, obviously, with the wetter water conditions, we're getting reduced emissions associated with peat oxidation, but we want to start putting more carbon back into the system so that we're removing as much carbon as possible. And we're doing that by increasing the carbon input, so by enhancing net primary productivity, so deciding on which crops are suitable for polluticulture to essentially maximise on the amount of carbon we can put back into the system. We're reducing carbon decomposition via re-wetting, so this is where we bring the water table up to the top sort of 10 centimetres. And we're looking at suppressing non-CO2 species of gases, so such as methane, by manipulating and adding stuff to the soil. So this is where biochar and some other bits come in. So this is essentially a conceptual model of what we're trying to achieve with GGRP. So on the left, you've got a conventional vegetable system. We've got drained system, we've got really high emissions associated with peat oxidation, and we're actually seeing a hell of a lot of peat loss. We have lots of supply chain emissions as well as biomass decomposition. So with the GGRP, we're obviously bringing the water table up, so we're suppressing decomposition, so we have reduced our emissions from peat oxidation, but we're actually growing crops and then either using them for biomass products that actually keep the carbon locked up, so you could use them for construction materials, or we could use it for a bioenergy plant, but obviously there is losses associated with that, but proportionately perhaps we could choose a proportion of the biomass that we're growing to put back into the system as biochar and then perhaps using the rest for energy sources. And it's all about just getting the mass balance right, so we just need to know what carbon we're putting in and what carbon we're putting out, and just making sure that we're actually removing carbon from the atmosphere. So the work that we're doing is being carried out at Polybell Farm, which isn't too far from here, it's near Gainsborough. And we have a parcel of four fields that we are working with. I'm going to be talking about the top left, but it's also just worth noting that we've got two other sites that we're doing, but they're upland sites, so we're not doing similar things, we're not practicing polluticulture, but the whole premise of the project is to remove carbon from the atmosphere. So if you have any questions, I can put you in touch with colleagues there. So we're running a set of polluticulture trials, and we've got several different species that we're looking. So we've got the conventional sort of polluticulture crops that we're trialing out, which is the Phragmites and the Typha. And we've got three varieties of Miscanthus. OPM4 and GNT43 are species that can deal with wet conditions, so that's why we've chosen those varieties, and we've also got some willow, and we're using a randomised block design, and we've got four blocks. Planting took place in May last year, and for those of you that are interested in knowing how to plug these plants in, we've got the Phragmites and the Typha went in as plug plants, the Miscanthus giganteus went in as rhizomes, and then the other two Miscanthus varieties went in as plug plants as well. And willows went into rods. And we sort of just followed commercial recommendations. So people that are doing this at scale, we just followed their advice for planting. So this Miscanthus here, it has, I've forgotten what you call it, like a plastic sheeting that goes over it to sort of encourage growth. But it actually did the opposite effect. It encouraged all the weeds to come out. So I wouldn't recommend that. And this is just to show you what it looks like now. I have got a video there, but I don't think it's, there's a little caterpillar eating our willow. But we've got this is our Miscanthus plant here. And if we have a look at the actual plant data, so to the left, we have establishment success rate. We had really, really poor establishment with the Phragmites and the Typha. And I think it's down to the fact that we didn't really prepare the land as we should have. It went into a grass. We had a lot of issues with weeds, and we weren't able to bring the water table up as high as we wanted to with the drought that we had last year. The Miscanthus we had amazing results with. We had 90% establishment success rate along with the willow. And you can see that we had better success with the plug plants. They are more expensive, but we did have better success, so I need to do the economic costings to figure out which one makes sense. But if you look at the biomass data, the OPM4, the wet varieties, and the GNT43 absolutely surpassed all the other plants that we were growing. We haven't got Phragmites and Typha in there because you don't take a cut from these in the first year, but it is general practice to cut it and then leave it on the ground. So we were able to take some samples. We're also measuring greenhouse gas measurements. So we've developed this chamber to deal with 3 meter tall plants. So we can stack the chamber up and sort of make it taller as the plant grows. And we're doing that on a monthly basis. And it's really early days, so I haven't really got that much data to show you, but this is just to show you the amount of carbon that's been put into the system by the plants. But like I said, we're not concluding anything from year one's data. So like I said, we're actually wanting to become a greenhouse gas removal system. So the water table, you know, reduces our emissions, but how are we going to become a removal system? And this is where if the plants can't deliver that on their own, we're going to have to look at amendments. So we're looking at applying biochar amendment to add carbon into the system. We're deploying these really fancy auto chambers, which will allow us to measure the fluxes continuously. Well, not quite continuously, but on a daily basis, hourly basis, to sort of capture any priming effects or anything that might happen to any slight change in conditions in the soil. We're also applying gypsum, and the gypsum is, there's evidence to show that it can suppress methane emissions. So the idea here is that when we have maybe perhaps a short flooding event, we're actually going to suppress the methane so we can maximise on our carbon removal potential. And so we're also going to be scaling up. We were meant to be doing it this year, but like I said, we learned from our mistakes. So we're now prepping the land in preparation for scaling up with the miscanthus. So we've got a grassland that has now gone into winter wheat. And in spring next year, we'll be planting the miscanthus GNT43 on a 4 hectare plot. And we'll be using flux towers. So this will be run by Ross Morrison. We'll use flux towers to actually measure CO2 and methane at a landscape scale rather than using our chambers. And this is continuously measured every single minute. So it's early days to conclude, but we have had successful establishment of the crops, and we did have wet conditions when we were doing that. The drought was later on in the summer. Preliminary data does show potential for greenhouse gas removal, but like I said, it is early days, and we're hoping that potential actually improves further down the line as the crops become more established. Just want to say thanks to everyone, and also, if you want to see any of the infographics that I showed for the WWF project, then hopefully that code still works, but you can scan that code, and that's a think piece that we produced for the agricultural community, just to sort of summarise all the potential options on agricultural lowland peat. And like I said, the report should be coming out in 6 weeks. So has anyone got any questions?
Life Moor space, which basically means we're spending some of the EU life money. Thank you very much, whoever gave it us. I'll cover some of the issues relating to lowland peatlands from my perspective and some of the solutions that we're cracking on with from a Lincolnshire perspective, and then I'm going to challenge you. There you go, that'll make one of my team very happy. She said, please tell me you're putting the photo of you with a bowl on your head. The most important thing of that picture, other than my mother was cruel, is the seahorse. I've been obsessed with nature from my youngest age. I've worked in farming in Lincolnshire, grading Brussels sprouts, cutting collies, blowing cabbages that were grown on peat as well. I am a true yellow belly. For those who don't know, that means born in Lincolnshire, but I'm a true fenner yellow belly. I have the genetic blood disorder to prove it. Lincolnshire Wildlife Trust is 75 years old this year. We're the second or third oldest wildlife trust. Our founding father, Ted Smith, went round the country and helped set up many of the other wildlife trusts, and also did work on helping set up the IUCN, if I remember rightly. I should remember, but I have an awful memory, I'm getting on. And this is Gibraltar Point. This was my playground as a child, and those who do know me know the centre of the universe is just at the end of that river, which is the River Steeping, which is called the Wash. So Lincolnshire Wildlife Trust is a membership charity. We still hold in our membership even at this time of financial crisis. So thanks to any of you who are members. We have around 100 nature reserves, depending on if the tide is in or out. If it is in, that equates to about 3,500 hectares. If it's out, it's about 7,000. That's the beauty of intertidal sites. If we take the intertidal out, as to say, our land holding from the Humber to the Wash is around 0.5% of the landmass of Greater Lincolnshire, which explains why we have to work with a lot of organisations, a lot of different sectors, and a lot of different partners and stakeholders. But as well as the staff, and there are several of us here today, because we have two lots of areas of peat down in the Fen and up here in the Humber Head, and it's a good chance for them to intermingle between themselves, let alone meet loads of other peatland practitioners. We are highly reliant on volunteers, so we have at least 1,000 people volunteering for us a year, putting in hundreds upon hundreds of hours. And that is not unusual for the Wildlife Trust family. There are 46 of us across the United Kingdom with one national body based at Newark. We are heading towards 1 million members, and we are the fifth largest landowner in the United Kingdom as a collective. Even with my meandering into Cambridgeshire and Nottinghamshire, I can't claim that for Lincolnshire. We have nationally adopted a strategy and then made it local. So the Lincolnshire simple word, Tammy, as we have three purposes: bring wildlife back, empower people to take action for nature, and to create a society where nature matters. So there you go, you know who's talking to you and why. Now let's crack on to peat. But let's think about the issues first. And when I talk about the issues for peatlands in Lincolnshire, therefore lowland peatlands, I'm talking about the widest context. So this chap who was, names Ted Smith, our founding father, as the inspiration for him, thinks it's 50 years. I do not. I think we've got about 10 to 15 years to make a difference for lowland peat. And that was before I saw the Durham University presentation where I wanted to weep when he said 10 years for Hatfield, parts of Hatfield. So there I am looking very grumpy because my mother did something stupid to my hair again. Bless my mum. The issues are obvious. We're in the middle of a biodiversity crisis. This plant used to be found on the upper salt marsh of the Wash. It now isn't in Lincolnshire. This is matted sea lavender. And that's because we reclaimed lots of land from the Wash, and that actually is some of our best grade one silt land that is the most productive for food that we require. So there are, you know, balances and checks in everything we do. But the United Kingdom is one of the most depleted nations on this planet in regards to biodiversity. Green and pleasant land, we are not for some species. I've jumped. Oh, I don't know how to go backwards. Basically, the slide was of two orchids. Well, it was the same species of orchids. Oh, that's by magic. Thank you. The specimen on the right is from the herbarium at the Natural History Museum. And basically, through using herbaria, we can tell how plants are changing. And that is telling us how our climate is changing. And basically, green-winged orchid are spreading. And have I said the right one? It's the one at Rush Furlong. I have little moments of daftness.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you, Neely. Basically, it is now flowering 10 days earlier, which if you think about over that 100-year period, that is a lot of change for a plant in 100 years. When we think about lowland plants, peatlands, and we want to think about the challenges. Sorry, I can't see over this thing. I'm just going to lower it. There we go. There. Ooh, this is now. Basically, politicians keep making promises locally and nationally that trees are the answer. We're going to plant a tree for every member of our residential population. Well, where are you going to find the land, mate? And also, you know, we all know peatlands is a superhero when it comes to the whole debate about climate change. So I'm not being rude about trees, although my surname tells you I'm not that keen on them, full stop. But peatlands do not get the awareness and the engagement politically or socially that they should. We all have a job to do in telling the story about the superhero that is peatlands, as well as salt marsh. This is the River Witham in November of last year. Nearly looks like you can walk across it. We all need water for our peatlands, but we don't need it full of the stuff that creates this. This is the other problem with water. We constantly have too much of it or too little. We're like, peatlands are like the Goldilocks of habitat. And so is water levels in Lincolnshire. So in 2019, when Wainfleet flooded, Black Sluice Drainage Board down in the south of the county pumped 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, to shift the water out, because they're a drainage board and that's what their ratepayers expected of them. Within 7 days, some of their farmers were asking for water. And we had just pumped it all out. And I said that to this group over here, so sorry for the repeating. We are stupid when it comes to water management. We have water everywhere in Lincolnshire. How are my peatland sites too dry? How are the farmers not able to access during their growing season? We need to be much more intelligent in regards to how we manage water at a catchment and landscape scale. Oh, it double jumped. Have I got a magnetic finger? Can you go back? Right, one. There we go. In the corner, You can see two water courses here, and then you can see one water course dropping down and basically a water body in the corner there. That's called Bourne North Fen. And you will see that that water body is kind of surrounded by a lot of agricultural land. And this aerial shot is to show you some of the peaty, note I'm going to say peaty, peaty areas of South Lincolnshire in the fens. And where we do have sites that we may be able to restore the peatland, we don't necessarily have buffers to those sites. Actually, I'm working with the farmers in this area and hopefully we will buffer this, it's a new site. Which brings us on to the other thing about Bourne North Fen. You'll notice you saw the water body. This is the arable bit that we've bought last year. I was very excited about this site. The Fens East Peat Partnership team, lovely Matt's here somewhere, and Lewis, who Natural England stole off me, was also part of that team. Oh, and Lorraine's here as well, lovely. Yeah, hello. Basically went out sampling and it turned out surface level peat, pants. Didn't meet the definitions of what may be called peat, even though there are peaty parts of this site. And then our historic environment specialists, who we contracted for the Fens East Discovery Grant project, went, well, don't be daft, it'll be underneath. You need to go deeper. So yes, a lot of our surface peat is not so great. But under Lewis, how much, or Hannah, how much is it? Under a metre? A metre down, we've got about a metre's worth of peat. So this comes to that question that was asked earlier. This is a submerged peat site. So you're all thinking, well, that's all right, it's underground. No, we're super at drainage. That submerged peat is oxidising. That's why our fen roads go all wibbly and bumpy. We need to, and this is a very clear issue, we need to address submerged peat oxidisation. And here in the Humberhead Levels, we had a practice called warping. So they have submerged peats here as well. We need to address that, not just surface level. We also need to recognise for lowland peats, it's where we grow food, people, and I like eating, quite obviously. I'm a hobbit, I have to have three breakfasts, and Brussels sprouts do have to be part of that. This is a Lincolnshire speak folk. This is a tert field, so potatoes to the rest of you. This is a tert field down in the fen. We need to realise we still need to produce food. In South Lincolnshire, we put 30% of all veg on the shelves of the supermarkets of Britain. We cannot suddenly not do that, because that means we are importing. And that brings a whole lot of other trouble our way in regards to carbon, but other practices. Innovation is required. And to enable innovation, we need to recognise the value of the crop in that field. And if we are asking a farmer who will be willing, I have many willing farmers, they need certainty about their income. And at the moment, that is one of the greatest barriers and issues. There is no certainty about income. We are directly trying to tackle that as an organisation. So, if you take away one issue that you can address, I would say this is going to be the most important, along with water. We need to provide certainty. And it isn't about them making a massive profit. This is their land that puts food on their family's table, because it is their business. And it is a business, I find, with my farmers that has existed beyond one generation. This is my grandparents. This is why I'm obsessed with the sea and the wash. The reason these families are willing to try anything is because they want to hand something on to their next generation. It is not just about profit and the environment. It's about individuals and their family history and their cultural heritage. So when we talk about lowland peatlands, we need to be mindful. We are talking about real people with real families, with real associations, with their landscape. So they're the issues. Enough of the boring problems. Let's crack on. Anybody who knows me. So based on the three goals that we have at the Wildlife Trust, lovely, lovely lad at the back. Could you go to the next slide? Maybe you should do mine. I'm very special, apparently. I found this in you ring McDonald's when you have that push screen thing. I always end up going to the till. It don't work. I have something. I have highly metallic blood. Maybe that's it. Who knows? Anyway. Overview of goal one. Obviously, we have nature reserves and we're looking to always acquire land, so we do nature recovery. Farming with nature is one of the work streams we deal with. Seed bank and plant propagation. Very important local provenance. Dikes, ditches, and verges. These sites do not need to be in isolation. And when you're talking of basically lowland peat, dikes are incredibly important. And peat restoration direct. So here we have it, connecting the dots. Bourne North Fen is smack bang in the middle of this image with a red dotty line around it. The important thing is it's on the confluence of the River of the Bourne Oak, dropping into the River Glen. The upstream of the glen is a SAC, or counter drainers, but the upstream of the River Glen is also relating to triple SIs. Downstream, the water quality gets a bit poorer because the Bourne is poorer water quality, but we do connect to a series of local sites and nature reserves, including Willow Tree Fen, where we have seen crane come back breeding. Well done, John. For the first time in over 420 years in Lincolnshire. So when we are dealing with talking to farmers and we are thinking about opportunities, we need to be thinking about connectivity and how it fits in a landscape, which is why I really loved, and I can't see you at all now, the project that was presented yesterday by Liz. Are you here, Liz? Yeah. Oh, you're there. Where they basically did the mapping for farmsteads with farmers and looked at it at a landscape scale. Beautiful piece of work. And we do actually look to upskill our farmers in lots of different ways, not necessarily just focusing on peat, but I am a Marks and Spencer's biodiversity advisor. I've just written their integrated water training package that will be going out this year to all the growers in partnership with LEAF, because somebody was talking about LEAF earlier, and FWAG, the Farming Wildlife Advisory Group, so that they start to think about water resource management, not only on farm, but as part of a landscape, and delivering to biodiversity gains as well as their own business gains for more resilience. Seed bank, if we are going to create more resilient lowland peatlands, we need to also ensure that plant diversity is maintained. Genetic plant diversity will enable plants to be as adaptive as they can to the changes that are coming through climate change. So local provenance native species need to be seed banked in partnership with the National Millennium Seed Bank, but having local ones that meet those standards, which we've set up in Greater Lincolnshire. This is the octopi of the Greater Lincolnshire Seed Bank, those who remember Mark Schofield. And we did trials with the University of Lincoln on propagating at a large scale using volunteers in their polytunnels. We are now going to transfer what we learnt with the university to two sites that are going to be funded by industry to set up plant propagations. And you know, there already are people who are specialists in sphagnum, so we need to talk to people who already have businesses in that and make sure that we work in partnership, don't take that business out of business, but you know, make sure we meet the needs of the United Kingdom's Lowland Peat. And back to connectivity. So Lincolnshire Wildlife Trust was the first wildlife trust to work in partnership with their Highways Council and take on protected roadside nature reserves. We have 66 of them, and they were developed in 1966, so figures I actually remember. But what we didn't do back then is think about all the dikes and drains. So we have been trialling with the Black Sluice Internal Drainage Board and Welland and Deeping Drainage Board through the South Lincolnshire Water Partnership and with funding from the Environment Agency, setting up regular monitoring of the drains within their catchments as drainage boards so that we can start to understand environmental change across those drains. And what we have found is, oh my days, they are beautifully rich in terms of their botanical interest, although water quality is a major issue. So when we were talking about peat, restoration and water, what we need is for those dikes and ditches to be part of that process as mini reservoirs, but also sites of botanical richness to enable lovely integrated land management. So when we come on to peat restoration, we were possibly one of the, I don't know actually, maybe you don't know, Jim. We were probably one of the bigger discovery grants that went in under the Nature for Climate Scheme. We were just shy of somewhere between 800,000 and 900,000. We are covering the whole natural character area of the Fens, number 46. We have over 20 sites. That includes with private land managers and landowners. So we have been working with farmers on their land, assessing their peats. We've undertaken level one, and well done to the FEP team. They trained up and they've been doing that level one peat sampling. So we have those skills in-house and we are training others how to do it. So it's about building that capacity. Level two, we had to bring in extra capacity just because there were so many sites. The historic environment, desk-based studies, all part of preparing to go into the restoration application, which is due in May. See you on the other side, people. See you on the other side. And one of the most important things with public money, you have procurement, and rightly so, and it has to be open and transparent. So the best way for us to do that, even though it took us much longer to get up and running, was to set up a framework contract where we could have a series of lots with different contractors, because there is a shortage in capacity of contractors. Maybe there isn't in the uplands, but there certainly is in the lowlands. We had people say, no, sorry, we've just got no capacity, not even to put in a tender, let alone do the work. So it is a real issue. So it's great to hear what you've been doing up in Lancashire. and we held events to address that, raising awareness with the public. So here are our 20 sites. We've already been approached by other land managers in this area now and farmers to join. I need to go into discussions about how we do that because the Discovery Grant ends in August and we have to have our Restoration Grant application in by the end of May. Up here in the Humberhead Levels, we have EU Life Moor Space, which I'll come on to. We have Precious Peatlands, which is the Canadians. We're not allowed to know who, but they have passed various tests, so in terms of ethics, by the National Wildlife Trust. The Canadians have given us money to buy land. The land just keeps increasing in price. And again, thanks, Mike, because you couldn't manage to buy yours. I've now got your underspend, so I can buy more. And we have a Discovery Grant up here, which again ends in August. And Julian Small did a lot of work on that application. And Mike and Mike from Yorkshire Wildlife Trust have done a lot in basically shivving us along as the leads. I'm going to give a special shout out to Melissa, wherever she is. I saw her earlier. Melissa works for Doncaster City Council. She has somehow made her chief exec understand all of this, and they gave us match funding to come in. So, thank you. So, what are we trying to do with EU Life Moor Space? We're trying to restore peatlands, the ones we've already got. But we're also trying to buffer them, so we do have money for land acquisition in regards to the specific area of Crowell and Thorn Moor, which is a special area of conservation. So we're going to improve what we already have, but also try to buy more of it to help continue that improvement. Never know. My first purchase might have gone through by the end of this week. We also recognise that we can't own all of it, and neither should we, so we have to engage, which is why we have the lovely Harriet. Where are you, Harriet? Oh, hiding over in the corner. There we go. Engaging with land managers adjacent to the SAC, talking about options of land management with them to help buffer our Natura site. And then we need to engage wider community to value our peatlands more and more and get involved with the ownership of them and empower them with the skills to deliver some of the things we need, like people keep talking about data and needing information on biodiversity. We don't have the resource to do that as an organisation, but we can train others to do it on a voluntary basis. And then that needs to be replicated. So we have relationships that we're going to be building with people in Denmark and other countries, but also within this country, which is why we were asked by EU Life to host this conference in regards to sharing best practice and knowledge in regards to Lowland Peats. And if you don't know where you're going tomorrow, well, if you're going to Thorn and Crowell anyway, this is the beauty. The bits on the left belong to Natural England, the bits on the right belong to Lincolnshire Wildlife Trust, is the easiest way to look at it. And if I've said me lefts and rights right as well. And when we think about the Humberhead Levels, this is an aerial shot, and I can't remember from what angle now. I knew I'd forget if I didn't have my notebook. Yeah, thank you. Looking southeast from the reserves warden, thank you. Across Crowell Moor. It's a big site. The first time I went there was about 10 years ago. I thought I had landed on planet. I'm from the Fen, but I didn't get the size, the wilderness factor of this site till I was studying it. It's remarkable. So if we then talk about empowering people, There you go. There's a lovely piece of work which Hannah and Lorraine did as part of the Fens East. If any of you would like copies of, we've got two children's booklets aged 8 to 10 and 10 to 12 year olds, we're happy to share them as PDFs and you can use them in your engagement practice. This has come through the Discovery Grant. They've been really, really well received. And for instance, at Wickham Fen, they're using them as part of their school's education programme. So Lorraine, could you just put your hand up? So if you want copies, can you ask Lorraine, because I'll never get round to it. I'm being honest. So goal two, we do partnership and influencing our environmental land management scheme tests, building land managers and farmers' skill base. Importantly, working on the next generation. I don't know about you, I think Mike's the same. I'm running out of steam, people. I'm of a certain age. I need some new blood coming in so I can retire. And integrating, and I've put Grimsby, which isn't renowned for being Lowland Peat, but we will come on to what I mean. This is my ode to the Beatles on the right. That, for those of you who don't know, that's Ian Worsop at the back, is the chief exec of Black Seuss IDB. And in front of him is Daniel, who's the chief exec of Water Resource East. And then a couple of the consultants working on Water Resource East come South Lincolnshire Water Partnership stuff. Doing this, going out, so it's Victoria Atkins, one of our MPs. That's Lord Taylor of the House of Lords. At the time, he was the chief whip in the House of Lords for the Conservative Party. And having those direct personal relationships with your politicians is really worth it. I used to work with Lord Taylor on the Marine Bill. He advocated it all the way through the House of Lords. On this particular trip, he enabled me to jump the queue so I didn't have to stand in the queue, which is a terrible thing to admit to. But it is having relationships with politicians, basically in the House of Commons and the House of Lords. If we truly want to make a policy difference or primary legislation difference, you need to have the ear of your politicians and not come across as a crazy lady, which you will understand I find quite hard. Lincolnshire Wildlife Trust, on behalf of two different partnerships, led two different elms tests, both in highly productive lands, both where peatlands were. I'm not going to go through all of the slides. I'm leaving these in so that when you receive the PDF of this presentation, you can read it. But importantly, based on what you were saying, Harper Adams, we actually did look at various things. Really importantly, we had vision events for both the Humberhead and South Lincolnshire, and the farmers said water and soils were their priority. But also we spoke with them about finance, what's the minimum and the maximum they hope to achieve per hectare. So if we're talking about money being a barrier, you need to read our reports on the tests, because in highly productive land, they need to be taking home somewhere between 500 and 1,500 per hectare to even be comparable to income foregone from them coming out of traditional cropping. And what is the payment rates for the Lowland Peatland Code? There's going to be challenges there. That is the reality of Lowland Peatland, where it's highly productive land. So we need to address how we are going to enable financing around that. And the second one we did was up here in the Humberhead levels. Both of these were landscape scale, obviously. Both looked at different policy questions and different tools. For South Lincolnshire, we did a natural capital assessment with the farmers involved in that process. And up in the Humber Head levels, we looked at land management plans and what tools they'd need for land management plans. In both cases, we also spoke to potential buyers of any ecosystem services. So there's information in both of the tests on that. This is the one I want to finish on with the Elms test, the last bullet on this slide. This was a farmer who had never been involved with any government schemes till this test, not even agri-environment. And by the end of this test, because real people who understood and were holding their hand, for want of a way of putting it, they will now consider going into either the green finance market and or stacking with agri-environment. That is the value of having local advisors who understand their local patch and the local pressure that a farmer is under. And that includes for peatland. I'm definitely struggling with this. So just to prove the fact that we engage, here is the fens. People don't realise the fens go up to Lincoln. And this is the peatlands dropping out, the historic peatlands, I hasten to add, dropping out of Lincoln, coming down the Witham Valley. The hands, is that your hand? It might be yours, Lewis, I'm not sure. But this is on one of our private farmers' land holdings. Is it Mark Tartellin's hand? Where we were doing peat sampling across one of our private land holdings. And there's Harriet on presumably some land up here in the Humber Head levels doing an advice day. Was it sampling, peat sampling, or what were you doing there, Harriet? Yes, a demonstration of peat sampling, there we go, sharing skills. We also had for the Discovery Grant in the Fens East, a MSc student come and work with us for as part of her degree. So upskilling and bringing on that next generation. And importantly, I sit on a board at the University of Lincoln. We helped design the BSc, and I sit on the board for the MSc for a nature recovery and practical skills. And we will be bringing them up here to the Humber Head levels. The MSc starts this autumn and giving them real life experience in how to be involved in peat restoration. It is incredibly important that we build the capacity in this field. So why is Grimsby here? This is one of my mild rants, people. I am sick to death of dealing with things in silos. I'm heading towards, well, it's at least 25 years I've been doing this. And basically, this is about surface level flooding, groundwater flooding, local people, the NHS, local business who wants to carbon offset. All in this one location, we have lots of issues to do with health. Well, get involved with the social services. They're now going to do some of my plant propagation. Design wetlands that can go on NHS and social services land and on the local authority land that can deal with the flood risk issues to do with groundwater, surface water. Get the local people helping to design those wetlands and to upskill them to manage those wetlands. Yes, use capital funding through the Innovation Flood Risk Funds, but then secure funding through a local business who's done everything to meet the various ISOs on carbon and reducing their carbon, but are left with some. Use their funding every year to manage the whole process. Integrate, integrate, integrate. Because we aren't going to achieve nature-based solutions if we don't crack on. And that includes work, No, I'll give up. That last one was nature in planning. Not only from a planning application process and a planning policy process, recognise that local planning authorities are just as stripped of resources as the rest of us, and they need a lot of skills, particularly around biodiversity net gain. Help them get there, don't let them drown. Oh, that was that slide. Nature-based solutions. Who understands this other than specialists? Get those specialists training others. On the left, that's my team being trained. On the right, that's a group of farmers at Dyson's Farm, biggest landowner in the country, where we worked with them to develop the first nature-based solution flood risk project using our native seeds of local provenance. Don't be scared to work with people you've never worked with. This is the Treasury. Oh my days. The Treasury has come knocking on my door twice in the last year. I've never had that. The Treasury, along with the London Stock Exchange, floated green bonds and green gilts. That has helped pay for the Nature for Climate programme and the Natural Environment Investment Readiness Fund. I now have a relationship with the Treasury. How bonkers is that? And green finance is absolutely critical. And I believe if you want to not get stung by the nettle, you might as well just grab hold of it and let you sting it from the outset. So in Greater Lincolnshire, we have, with all the local authorities, with landowners, with buyers, set up the Green Investment in Greater Lincolnshire project. We have just ran the first expression of interest to fill the seller's registry, which is farmers who want to sell credits in biodiversity, water or carbon. And we have just about to run the registry for the buyers, and we will help facilitate that process. And always, always, and it goes back to the Grimsby example, look for multiple benefits. This is Bourne North Fen. Yes, it will save carbon by just not ploughing it, between 10 and 30 ton per year per hectare. But we are going to use this site to reduce some of the uncertainty for farmers in this area about what it costs to set up and what it costs to run and what we can sell. Real life example. There are changes upon us. There were changes after World War II. I believe we are at the next epoch of land use change. We can either make this planet better or we can completely cock it up. The challenge is quite simply climate change and biodiversity decline. If we don't address these two things, it doesn't matter if we've got food in our bellies, because we'll get wiped out by something else. Food is important, and I have worked in the sector, so I will always say we cannot lose all food production, but we need innovation in food production. There are power stations all around this country producing waste heat and possibly, you know, carbon dioxide. Why aren't we pushing that through glass houses, people, and growing vertical crops? Can somebody tell me that? We need to think differently about challenges. I am short, I am dyslexic, I am often lost in large crowds because of my height, but do I let that stop me? No. I am, and this really is my rant, really, really, really fed up of people focusing on barriers and issues and saying we need more of this, more of that. We need to be purists, we need to be perfectionists. We have failed. It is time we innovate and take risks and pull down the barriers. 10 years till parts of Hatfield peats have gone, that is not acceptable. It is time to stop wanting perfection. It is time to take action and risk. Because if we don't start thinking in a different way and acting in a different way, we will fail. And that is not acceptable to me. We need to take action. We need to enable farmers to innovate. We need to move forward and stop focusing on yesterday and start focusing on today for a better tomorrow. Thank you for listening.